The 7th of June, 1819. Madam, you throw me into despair. You repeatedly accuse me of failing in delicacy, as if on your lips this accusation were nothing. Ah, madam, it is easy for a man who has no passion to conduct himself always with moderation and prudence. I too, when I can hearken to my own counsel, I believe that I am not lacking in discretion. But I am dominated by a fatal passion that leaves me no longer master of my actions. I had sworn to myself to take coach, or at least not to see you and not to write to you until you returned. A force more powerful than all my resolutions dragged me to the places where you were. I perceive all too well that henceforth this passion is to be the great concern of my life. All interests, all considerations have paled before it. This fatal need I have of seeing you carries me away, dominates me, transports me. There are moments in the long, solitary evenings when, if it were necessary to commit a murder that I might see you, I would become a murderer. In the midst of the confusion of my whole being into which I am thrown by the imperious necessity of seeing you, there is nevertheless one quality which I have preserved, and which I pray that destiny will continue to preserve for me, unless it seeks to plunge me in my own esteem into the underworld of abjection, the quality of perfect truthfulness. You tell me, madam, that I so greatly compromised matters on Saturday morning that in the evening it was necessary for you to act as you did. It is the word compromise that wounds me to the bottom of my soul. And if I had the good fortune to be able to pluck out the fatal affection that pierces my heart, it would be this word compromise that gave me the strength to do so. Had I the talent to seduce you, and I do not believe that such a talent exists, I would not use it. Sooner or later you would perceive that you had been deceived, and to lose you after having possessed you would still be more frightful, I think, than if heaven had condemned me to die without ever having been loved by you. When a being is dominated by an extreme passion, all that he says or does in a particular situation proves nothing concerning him. What bears witness for him is the entirety of his life. Thus, madam, were I to vow all day long at your feet that I loved you or that I hated you, this should have no influence upon the degree of credence that you decided to grant me. It is the entirety of my life that should speak. Now, although I am very little known and still less interesting to the people who know me, yet you might inquire, for lack of another topic of conversation, whether I am known to lack either pride or constancy. Love me if you will, divine Matilda, but in God's name do not despise me. Such torment is beyond my strength to endure. In your manner of thinking, which is very just, if you despised me, it would be impossible for you to ever love me. With a soul as lofty as yours, what surer way could there be of earning your displeasure than that which you accuse me of having taken? I so much fear to displease you that the moment when I first saw you on the evening of the 3rd, the moment which should have been the sweetest of my life, was on the contrary one of my most wretched, by reason of the fear I had of displeasing you.